Welcome to the SwimSwam podcast. I'm your host, Coleman Hodges. Joining us today, newly crowned short course world championship silver medalist in the 50 freestyle. She is the comeback queen of Las Vegas / Poland. Today, we're sitting down with Kasia Wasick. How's it going?
Hi, I'm really excited to be on SwimSwam podcast.
We are excited to have you. Let's start with that 50 freestyle silver medal. You just keep racking up international hardware. It's exciting to watch. It's really impressive as a swim nerd to see you just keep rolling on this comeback. Heading into this meet, I'm most curious about, you just focus on one event, right? You had a really great World Cup series. You were swimming you were branching out a little bit, but coming into this short course worlds, you just do the 50 free. Do you like just having the one race to focus on?
Absolutely. Going to a longer season, even I focus only on the 50 freestyle, and you know, training for 50 and 100 is completely different. And I was always annoyed that I cannot focus on my own event. Like fully focus on my own event. I was always doing 100, and you know, like coaches were putting me in 200. I was even swimming 500 in college, and I had a feeling that I'm a sprinter, like pure sprinter, and I'm a 50 freestyler. But I never had a chance to fully focus on that event, on that distance, until I came back from my retirement, and I gave it a try, and I started specializing in 50 freestyle. And of course, the 100 is always there. I like racing 100 for training. And sometimes it's just a good, you know, I don't, you know, it's like focusing on one event. It's really mentally exhausting. So having something else, it's nice because it lets me feel the pool, lets me peel the walls and just have fun with the event. And if I'm able to race it, I'm gonna do it. But mentally, I'm all for 50 freestyle. So yeah, the long course was definitely like my, this year was the first time I was like, I'm really focusing on the 50, and the 100 is just there. Short course is obviously different because it's a little bit easier. You have the walls. So racing World Cups, I knew, you know, it's gonna be hard to race 100 because I haven't been fully training for it, but I can do it. I believed in myself, and you know, I've done it so many times that I knew what I'm doing. So yeah, I added 50 fly too for fun, and it was really a great experience.
Aside from the racing, what do you feel like you get out of going to those World Cups?
It was actually my first time in my whole career that I was able to go to and do World Cups. So I didn't know what to expect. I mean, I knew ISL before, but the experience is a little bit different. So I was really surprised how nice it was. We had a lot of fun with other athletes. I had a chance to meet other athletes, and yeah, just focus on my events. This year was really fun, like aspect of like getting a crown. So yeah, I was excited about that 50 freestyle because I knew I'm able to do it, and every time I would start with the 50 freestyle too. So I would race my main event, and then I would just have fun and race as many events I could. So it was definitely a great experience, and I would love to do it again next year if I'm gonna have a chance. But I'm really thankful I was finally able to go and experience that.
So heading into having that experience at World Cup, and then heading into Short Course Worlds in Melbourne, do you consider racing another event like like the 50 fly, for example, that wouldn't seem to take too much other training or might just be another event, either a warm-up event or something for fun?
Yeah, so like I said, short course is different. I feel like we can race so much short course without being exhausted, and racing ISL really showed me that I can have multiple events and still be able to perform, you know, and have a great 50. That's why I raced the 100 before the 50 at the world champs, because even though we completely erased the race from my training, I just want to have fun. I didn't want to sit around and wait for my race. So I told my coaches that doesn't matter what place I'm gonna get, I just wanna get up and race, because that's what I love. And just sitting makes me more exhausted than actually racing. So that's why I added that extra event. A long course, I don't know if I would do it. Probably not, because it's completely different racing. But it just depends on your training. I just didn't train for it, so it was a little bit different.
Okay, so you did do the 100 free. And okay. I'm looking at this now. You moved on to semifinals. You were ninth. You went 52-4. So that's, that seems like a good showing. And you got some races in, like you said.
Yeah, I was going into Australia. I had a really hard time. Like I'm still trying to figure out. I think it was like a combination of jet lag, travel, and then probably like getting over some virus. But when I raised that 100 and I got ninth, I knew I'm like, it's gonna be a tough meet. But at the end, like, I knew I want to swim that race, and it was my decision to race. Probably if it would be up to my coaches, they would erase me from that 100. But I accepted it. I want to swim, and if I make that decision, you know, I have to go with it. And I was happy. At the end, I was happy that I got to race and I wasn't sitting around and just waiting and being mentally exhausted.
Yeah. Why did you feel like it was going to be a tough meet because of the 100 freestyle? What about the 100 freestyle told you that?
It wasn't because of the 100 freestyle. It was just how I felt in Australia, how I felt even before going to Australia. I just didn't feel 100% myself. This season was just, it was the best season of my career. The best year of my career. I got so many medals, probably the most medals I've got my whole career. And I swim for over 20 years. So I'm really excited, but I was struggling a lot with my health and I was trying, it was just crazy to like, sometimes I didn't know what I'm going to get, even going to the World Cups. I was struggling my shoulder, and then I had accident walking down the stairs, and I twisted my foot, and I couldn't walk for days. And my coaches were like, "Oh my God, like what can we do with your training?" And I was really proud how we modified the training. Sometimes it wasn't easy to, you know, we couldn't do 100% of like normal stuff. We had to tweak my training and do more kicking than more pulling when I had the foot injury. So I was really proud of like adjustment we made together, and it worked out. I mean, like World Cups, I swam faster every race, and even in Berlin, I was so lucky, like swimming the 50 freestyle day one in Berlin. Like thinking about that crown, you have to swim three times and you have to win three times. And after 50 freestyle, I got food poisoning and I ended up going to the hospital. And, you know, it was just a crazy experience. I was like, I can't believe this is happening to me. You know, it's like stuff over top, but like, I try to stay, like on my goal. And even though, like, you know, like the doctors cleared me and the next day I was like green and I still raced the 100 freestyle. I was lucky I had my brother and, you know,
The
my
next
coach.
day.
Yeah, I did it. It wasn't a pretty 100 freestyle. I was a lot like off. I think I went like 53 something. But, you know, it was just like, it wasn't even about time. It was just about my mental preparation. I felt like you know, every time I train so much for that one race, when it comes, I just want to have a chance to race. Even though sometimes I'm not going to swim my best times, I feel like just getting out there and fighting your mental, like mental game and showing like, hey, I can do it. Even though I'm not 100%, that's going to prepare me for the big race, because who knows, you know, we deal with a lot of, you know, injuries. We deal with, you can wake up and have a bad day and you have to be ready to race. Otherwise, you're going to lose that one chance and it's never going to come back. So I've learned a lot. And, you know, getting to Australia, that was the time that I didn't feel good. I don't know why, if I was getting sick, but, or, you know, having really bad jet lag. But yeah, like I didn't feel good, but I tried to like convince myself like, hey, like I trained for it, you know, I'm ready and I'm gonna race. And then after 100 freestyle, you know, I went off my best time, off the time that I was being going in Indy, you know, or Toronto or Berlin. So I knew it's gonna be a tough meet, but I have no choice, you know, like I have to, 50 is completely different race. So I didn't want to base my whole meet on the 100. I just, you know, had a race and closed the book and moved to the 50 freestyle. So, yeah, that was my experience.
That sounds like a wild ride, but it also sounds like you were extremely resilient and you used this experience as training and as preparation. And obviously it prepared you pretty well. So you're in Australia, you weren't feeling 100% just because of the travel to Australia. You're getting over a virus. You get ninth in the 100 free. Take me through the 50 free and how you were feeling through the rounds. You know, you're top seed through prelims, through semis. You go 23-3 in semis, and then in finals, you go 23-5. You get second to Emma. Take me through that 50 freestyle.
So yeah, like I said, you know, after that 100 freestyle, I closed the book and I was like, okay, 50 freestyle, that's my main event, and that's what I've been training for. But it's tough, like being a swimmer and going to the meeting feeling like, hey, I'm not in my best shape. And I know that, you know. And even though I was going with the top seed to the meet, I knew, you know, I knew Emma's times and I knew I have to be like my best behavior and I'm gonna have to go my best time to even, you know, be in the game to win with her. But feeling that I'm not 100% made me worried, and I was just like, you know, one race at the time, right? One race at the time. So I raced prelims and you know, came back to the room and I tried to get sleep, as much sleep as possible to feel better. Then I did the second round, semifinals, and even though I would be, you know, top seed after prelims and semifinals, I knew I wasn't getting excited or anything. I just knew, you know, Emma is in excellent form, and doesn't matter that I'm top seed after semifinal. Everything can happen in the final. So yeah, I mean, I just try to forget that I'm not feeling good and have a good race, because I knew that chance never gonna come back. You have only one chance. And then that's our sport. I mean, and we train so much for it, and we can't waste that chance. You know, it's only gonna happen once. And the next next chance is going to happen in 2 years. So it's crazy.
So looking back on that now, just reflecting on that meet, how do you feel about your performance and the way you handled the 50 free final?
You know, I'm so happy that I managed to get the silver. You know, I'm in last year in Abu Dhabi, I got bronze. This year I got silver, and so I'm making progress. I made best time long course. I did my best time short course this season. So I'm going forward, and that's what makes me happy. I was extremely happy after this meet because I knew how much it took to get that silver. I could easily miss the podium because just the way how I felt, the way how I executed the whole race. It wasn't the perfect race, and so it could be way worse. Yeah, I was extremely happy with the whole year, with getting medal for my country. Extremely proud to represent Poland, rocking my Magic Five goggles in the pool. So it's just so many great memories, and meeting Emma for basically the first time. I mean, I raced with her in Tokyo in the Olympic final, but you know, Olympics are completely different. I mean, we never get a chance to talk. So I was excited to meet her, and really impressed by her.
Yeah, what impressed you about her?
Just her class, you know. She's extremely classy and nice, and it was a pure it was just a pure competition in the pool. It wasn't, you know, nothing personal or anything. It was just like, yeah, we're both training for it, and whoever is better is gonna win. Yeah, she's really positive, really have a good energy, but she's extremely classy, and I really liked it.
Yeah. So it sounds like an overall successful season. I'm looking at your medal count now between December of 2021 and December of 2022. Like you said, you won the most medals of your career this season. That includes 5 silvers, which is a lot of hardware. And like you said, you're making progress. How do you feel about that number of 5 silvers?
I feel pretty good. Like, I can't complain. And you know, I'm really grateful that I was able to come back to swimming. And if I wouldn't take that chance, I mean, take that risk, basically, because coming back to swimming, I had to make some choices that involved putting away my career and focusing on swimming, and you know, the beginning I wasn't making any money. Like, I had to like support, my husband had to support me and my family, and we didn't know what's gonna happen. You know, my goal was to only qualify for my 4th Olympics, and I didn't have like any expectation from it. I was like, I know I'm able to qualify for it in my next Olympics, but if you would tell me I'm gonna win 5 medals, I don't know if I would believe. But I made that choice, and every day I would go to the pool, and I just try to give my 100% and try to really work hard, because I didn't want to give like any less, because otherwise I would wake up in 5 years and I was like, what was I doing? You know, playing with you know, my life. It just not the way I wanna end my career. So I really gave my best, and I'm really happy that I was able to represent my country. You know, I'm always really proud of that, and I feel really motivated for the next years. I made the choice to keep swimming, and I have a lot of fun. I meet such amazing people. like your event.
Made the list.
I always have like a full smile when I see, you know, all the swimmers and the crew, and I'm looking forward for 2023 and then 2024 Paris. The Olympics are gonna be in Europe. I feel like, you know, I know Europe so well, so it's gonna be a little bit different than going to Australia or Tokyo or Beijing, you know. So I'm really excited.
Yeah, I mean, I'm excited just hearing you talk about it, especially. It is wild that what could be your fifth Olympic Games could also be your best shot at winning an Olympic medal. I don't want to get too far ahead of myself.
Let's leave it like that.
Let's leave it like that. All right, I have a couple more questions. You're training and living in Las Vegas for the last few years. I went to Las Vegas. You weren't there. You were avoiding me. I'm really hurt by it. But I did get to see where you train at UNLV. They did some really awesome stuff, including the Speed Wars. Is that what it's called?
Speed Wars, yeah.
Which is where they turn it the pool into a 15 meter pool, and then you just do 15 or 30 meter sprints. What they say, you were the best. What makes you so good? I feel like you're living everyone's dream where you were like, I think I'm a sprinter. And most swimmers have that mentality of, I think I'm a sprinter, but you actually are. And you are fulfilling that now. Tell me about Speed Wars and why, and what makes it so great.
You know, we are so lucky in Vegas at the UNLV that we have this incredible pool, and we can move the bulkhead and basically choose the how long it's gonna be the pool. So I laugh because every day I go to the pool, it's a different length, and I'm like, I just can't get used to the any length, because it's like Mondays we have long course, Tuesdays we have meters, you know, 25 meters, then Wednesday it's yards. And then the next day it's like the ultra course, which is like the 50 meter pool, and we just race 15s. So every day is something different, and it teaches you different stuff. So I'm definitely lucky. I mean, it's awesome to be a pure sprinter. Definitely, you know, like I wouldn't, even though it's also a harder work, and we have to work a lot on details and technique, and sometimes it's really frustrating. I wouldn't trade with the long distance swimmer. Definitely not. But even, you know, sometimes I laugh because I'm really, you know, I can go fast the first 15 or like 25 to 50, and then I'm dead. And I need the time to recover. I'm like, and I feel so out of shape. And I'm like, am I an athlete? Like, what's going on? You know, so it's a blessing, but also a curse. But I'm just racing, and especially racing, you know, gets me so excited. And when we do the Speed Wars, usually like you have the whole team cheering for you from outside, and you just race and you look at your time, you know, when you get up, race again, you know. And when I have people cheering for me, and you know, you add the part of racing that I'm like, you know, I feel like this is the coolest thing ever, then I just go for it, you know. I can really have my mind into the thing that I really love, which is both having my teammates but also racing short distance.
Do you know your best times for 15 and 30?
So 15, I never broke the 6 seconds on the.
So that's I'm what like, I thought. Yeah, I thought that's what Pat told me.
Yes, so it's that's our goal. When you know, it's we always laugh when I break that time. When I break 60 seconds, then I'm, you know, on the world record pace. So I'm chasing that. But it's fun. I'm really, you know, I don't think many pools can do it, or even if they do it, you know. And the fact that we do it every week makes the training really fun and special. So yeah, I feel incredibly lucky that our coach is using that in our training.
Is it 15 yards or 15 meters?
Yards. Oh, okay. Actually, I mean, wait, no, meters. Sorry, meters.
Okay, yeah. 15 yeah. meters. Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
yeah. And your best time is 6.0 for a 15 meter. Do you know your best time for a 30?
No, I mean, not many times I do 30, actually.
Okay, it's just 15. I also love that it's called ultra course.
Yeah,
for 15 meters.
Yeah, we do a lot of fun stuff, and I was really sad I wasn't avoiding you. I was really sad I wasn't there. I was at the training camp in Turkey. I told you that, so don't blame me. But yeah, I watched the podcast, and it was really fun, and all the teammates were really happy to see you. So.
Yeah, you did. I was totally kidding. You were not avoiding me. I have to come back because Las Vegas really sold me, on everything in and out of the pool. Between you and sandpipers, it's like, why would I not come back? This is the swimming mecca. Yeah. It seems
we have everything. We have distance swimming. We have sprint swimming. It has to be something in the water in Nevada.
Seriously. Yeah, I'm curious. I mean, obviously people go to Las Vegas to have a good time outside of the pool, and it's what it's known for. I'm just curious what you like or what you enjoy to do in Las Vegas when you're not swimming or training or, you know, super focused on it.
Hiking. I go hiking all the time, you know, in Vegas is right in the middle of everything. So, me and my husband are always exploring, finding different, you know, hiking spots, and we love going to Utah, or you know, just staying in Vegas, or going to Arizona, or going to California. It's Vegas is right in the middle, so you can always find something, and it's a lot of fun to explore nature. I'm a big nature freak, and so. So it's yeah, it's not only, you know, the strip and the party aspect of the city, but also you have really calm and fun nature part.
That was like one of the coolest parts to me was that, you know, you're on the strip, and then in 20 minutes you're in the suburbs, and then in another 20 minutes you're in the desert, or you know,
did
you're
you
in the
go,
mountains.
Did you go anywhere outside strip?
Well, you know, I went Sandpipers was like in the burbs. Mm-hmm. Right. And then we kind of went and explored that area a little bit, but I didn't go into the mountains.
You have to come back. That's the perfect, you know.
I'm sold. You don't have to tell me twice. I really want to. My last question is about this coffee place we went to. So this place is it like on lists. I don't know if you how big of a coffee drinker you are, but on like some lists, it's like the best coffee shop in the US only because it has 5.0 stars on Yelp or on Google.
Mm-hmm.
It has 187 reviews. I'm just prefacing this for our listeners so they don't get outraged. It's called Yaw Farm Coffee Roaster. Have you heard of this place?
No, but now I'm going to have to go.
It's pretty cool. It's like one guy, and he makes it's a pretty small menu. Mm-hmm. And he makes every drink by hand to order. And so it's not like you don't go there if you're like in a rush or if you like it, you know, it's not quick and it's not bulk. I think you can only get like two or four drinks per order. Like you can't do.
I never heard of it. I'm gonna have to go and check it out. Yeah. I love coffee, so yeah, it's gonna be my next trip
to a cafe. Yeah, that's my Vegas recommendation. That's what I did that stuck out. Awesome. And then we went to the Shaq's chicken place. What's that called?
I don't know.
Okay. That's where the UNLV coach took
me here. I don't know anything.
No. That's where the UNLV coach just sent me. Anyway.
Yeah.
Well, Kasia, it's always great talking to you. Thank you for taking the time to come on the pod and break down your experience this season racing and in Melbourne. Any parting thoughts before we sign off?
Well, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure, and happy new year. Keep your fingers crossed for another exciting year in swimming.
You've been listening to the SwimSwam podcast. Stay tuned for new episodes every week. You can take SwimSwam podcasts on the go by subscribing on your favorite podcast platform. Look for links in the description below, and be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel for more videos as well.